Hello. In today's module, we will be discussing about perception. So what exactly is perception? First, let's understand some pictures and let's see how you perceive them. What do you see in this picture? Do you see a musician playing a trumpet or do you see a girl's face? How about this picture? Do you see some boat sailing in the sea or do you see a bridge, a long, long bridge? And how about this picture? Do you see two horses, an eagle, and some mountains? Or do you see a beautiful face? Now, how you perceive certain things depends on various factors. But first of all, let's understand what exactly is perception. Perception is the act of seeing what is there to be seen. But what is seen is influenced by the perceiver, the object and its environment. According to Stephen Robbins, let's understand the definition of perception. It is defined as the process by which individuals organize, interpret their sensory impression in order to give a meaning to their environment. Now, what are these sensory impressions? These include the five senses: your touch, taste, sight, smell, and sound. All these five senses play a very important role in forming your perception. So, therefore, perception is the process by which an individual selects, organizes, and interprets information to create meaningful picture. So, here we see two different things. You can perceive it in two ways. You can see a beautiful vase, or you can see two beautiful side faces. What are the factors which affect perception? Now, there are three factors that affect perception. It could be related to the perceiver, it could be related to the perceived, and it could be related to the situation. So let's understand the factors related to the perceiver. The first factor is projection. So here the perceiver, he tries to project his personality attributes in others. For example, if a person is very talkative, so he will also treat the other person who he's trying to perceive, he will also think that the other person is also very talkative. That is basically he is projecting his personality attributes into others. Another factor related to perceiver is the mental makeup. Sometimes the perceiver, he will have some preset notion in his mind about certain objects, certain events and certain people. The moment he has to deal upon these events, he already knows how to act or already knows how to react as he has his own mental setup to deal with such a situation. He has already been in a certain situation where he has already dealt with certain objects, events and people, and therefore he will deal with those people accordingly. The third factor is stereotyping. When we talk about stereotyping, we are talking about a tendency to judge people based on the perception of the group to which he belongs. For example, we perceive the Japanese in general are very hardworking. They're very quality conscious and also industrious. And based on that, we generalize that all the Japanese are like that. But in reality, it may not be so. There are some Japanese who may not possess all the above mentioned characteristics. But here, we have been able to form a perception about Japanese because of the stereotyping. The fourth factor is known as the halo effect. Now, halo effect is a tendency to draw a general overall impression about an individual based on single striking characteristic. For example, if you see this image, we have one single striking characteristic, which is attractiveness, and it is assumed or it is perceived that attractive people are smarter, they're funnier, and more likable than less attractive people. Another example would be, for example, if a person speaks English fluently, we tend to perceive that that person is very knowledgeable, he's very intelligent, smart, clever, hardworking, etc., just on the basis of one characteristic, that is, he can speak English fluently. So this is basically a halo effect. The fifth characteristic or the fifth factor which affects, which is related to the perceiver is the recency effect. Now, recency effect is the effect that the recent event has on the perceiver. For example, during the performance appraisal, the employees are rated on the basis of their latest performance. The earlier performance is ignored. This is not the satisfactory method, so it leads to the error of the perception. So these are the factors which are related to the perceiver. Now, what are the factors related to the perceived? One could be the status of the perceived. So when perception is made about a person who has high status in terms of position and wealth, he is generally perceived to be high on ranking than a person with low status. So a status can also determine the ranking of the person in that society. And that is how you can perceive about the perceived person. Now the next one is the closeness with the perceived. So if a person is close to another person in relationship, the perceived will be ranked high because of this relationship, even though in a particular situation he may have behaved negatively. For example, let's see the two prison mates. Now for others, these two will be perceived negatively, but for each other, they are close to each other, they have a close relationship with each other since they live together and they have friendship with each other. So the perceived will be ranked higher because of the relationship. But even if they have behaved negatively in other situation and other people are also perceiving them negatively, for each other, due to the closeness of with the perceived, he will be ranked higher. These are the factors that are related to the perceived. Now let's see the example of the factors related to the situation. Now here, the situation also plays an important role in forming perception about a person. A person, let's say if he's sitting in a 5-star hotel, he may be perceived differently than a person sitting in a small hotel. Just because the situation is different, he's sitting in a 5-star hotel, he will be perceived differently as very smart, attractive, intelligent, rich. All these factors, all these perceptions will build up just because he's sitting in a 5-star hotel. Or let's take the example of this. Just because of the situation where Prince William is clicked at the wrong angle, he has been perceived differently. Whereas you can see in the front angle, this is not what he meant. The wrong gesture was not meant to be. But because of the situation, he has been perceived wrongly, right? So these are the three factors which can affect the perception. Now let's see the perceptual process. The perceptual process has three stages. The first stage is selectively perceiving through our senses, the five senses. So we pay attention to what meets a need or is enjoyable. The second stage is organizing. We evaluate according to our unique mental schemata and we organize according to how we think things should be or should not be. And the third stage is we interpret. We take all that event, objects and persons, we organize all the information and then we interpret it. That is, what does it mean to me? Now, let's see the each stage in a little detail. So the first step is selection. When we talk about selection, it is the process by which we attend to some stimuli in our environment and not others. Now, these stimuli can be internal or external. So the internal stimuli could be your personal motive, your incentives, impulses, and drives to act in a certain way. Or it could be external stimuli such as bright lights and colors, loud sounds, strong odors, spicy flavors, or painful contact. All these may also lead to selection of certain objects, certain events, or certain persons, and rejecting other information. For example, we take the effect of the cocktail party effect while we are doing selection. So when we talk about a party, for example, we are just focusing on one particular stimulus and we are filtering out a range of other stimuli. That is, for example, if a party goer from the loud noise in a noisy room, music, lighting, he just is able to neglect all those factors and is able to focus on one single conversation, that is basically the selection of that particular information. Or, for example, this particular image where you can see that one person is just sitting and reading a newspaper and there's a conversation which is going on behind in the background. Now here he is not concerned about the conversation, so he is not selecting any conversation. So all blah 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 is happening until he hears his name in the third image where you can hear his name, that is Herb. As soon as he heard his name, or he noticed his name being spoken in another conversation, he was a better listener and he got involved in that conversation. He was selecting that information, right? And there the process of perception started. So nothing makes you a better listener than hearing your name mentioned. And that is where the selection has started. So once you select the information or the object or event or person, then you have to organize all that data into meaningful categories, into meaningful picture. So organization is the second stage, is how we mentally arrange information into meaningful and digestible patterns. So perceiver here is influenced by, first of all, figure and ground approach, and the second one is perceptual grouping. So we'll discuss all these in little detail, but first understand that these terms were coined by Gestalt psychology, which is basically a school of psychology that emerged in earlier 20th century. Now these psychologists, they emphasize that organisms perceive entire patterns or configuration, not merely individual components. So a unified whole is much more than sum of elements. So if you see this picture here, this is Gestalt for visual design. Here you can see multiple elements or multiple things which are placed in the picture, but we see it as one unified whole. So here you can see a tree, but in the backdrop you can also see on the side, on one side, on the left hand side, you can see a chimpanzee, and on the other side you can see a lion, and on top you can see some birds. So all these are combined together to form one picture. You have taken multiple pictures and you have organized it in such a way that it looks like a unified whole, right? So the first approach is basically the figure and ground approach when we are organizing. So what a person here, what happens is, what a person observes is dependent on how a central figure is being separated from its background. So when you see this picture, what comes to your mind? You see two apples, one is red, one is green. But if you look clearly, if you look more in a more detailed way, here you are able to see a picture in the center, in the black background also. The central figure is dependent or and is separated by the background, and the background is created in such a way that it showcases the photo of an individual, which is Steve Jobs. So here the perceiver tends to organize only the information which stands out in the environment, which seems to be significant to the individual. So for example, when you are in a dance program, when you go to watch a dance program, the spectators, they often tend to perceive the dance performance, and they tend to neglect the background music, the backdrop setup, everything they tend to neglect, and they focus more on the dance performance. That is basically the figure and ground approach in perception. Now when we talk about perceptual grouping, here we group all these stimuli into organized patterns, and it happens on different bases. Now first basis would be the proximity. Here the people tend to perceive things which are nearer to each other, as together, as group, rather than separately. So if you see four or five members are standing together, even if they don't know each other, but we tend to perceive that they belong to the same group rather than separately. So even people who are working in the same department or employees in a particular section, they are seen as a group. This is basically because of proximity. Okay, this is how you organize information. So here you can see, this is in these patterns when you are before you can see some dots, but when you group these dots together, you are able to identify one set from the other set. This is basically how you have organized the information in a way to interpret it differently. The second basis is the similarity, the law of similarity, where persons, objects and events that are similar to each other, they are grouped together. Now how it helps? It basically helps to deal with information in an efficient way rather than getting bogged down and confused with too many details. So grouping really helps. So all those things that are similar, we group them together in our brain, and so it helps in interpreting the picture more clearly. So for example, you see a group of foreign nationals at an international seminar. You tend to group Indians as one group, British as one other group, Americans as another group, Japanese as another group. So this is basically how you organize the information so that too much information is not bogging you down. So here you can see how it is grouping one group of people from another group of people. The third basis of organizing is basically your closure, the law of closure. In this situation, the information what we intend to get may be in bits and pieces and it's not fully complete, but we tend to perceive it. We automatically, our brain automatically fills up those gaps of the missing parts and we make it as a meaningful whole. So even if we are given some bits and holes of information, bits and pieces of information, we complete it into a meaningful whole. And such mental process of filling up the missing information, it's known as closure. So here in this picture, you can see that there are various elements being put together and you can see it as a unified whole, which is a panda. And in this picture, again, you can see some black pieces being put together in certain way and you can make out that it is a ball, a football. So this is basically the law of closure, where you are able to take all the bits and pieces of information and you're not fully completely aware of all the information, but you tend to interpret it in such a way on that you have a perception about certain things. So this is a law of closure. The third part of the process of perception is, or the third stage is interpretation. This is the last stage where perception, is basically in this stage of the process, we represent and understand the stimuli. So all the information that we have selected, we have organized in our brain, we tend to put it into categories and we superimpose it onto our lives to give it a meaningful picture. So interpretation is again subjective. That means every individual will come up with a different conclusion. It will not come out to be the same conclusion for all the information. So if you give same information to different individuals, they will come up with different interpretation of that, or they will interpret or they will perceive it differently. Okay, so how is it affected? It is affected by the values, the needs, beliefs, experiences, expectations, self-concept and various other personal factors. That how these things will basically make you interpret it differently. So if you see this picture, in this picture you can see the same thing, that is a swing made out of a tire, has been interpreted differently by different individuals because of the different factors. And this is how, in the first picture you can see, this is how the customer explained it, how the project leader understood it, how the engineer designed it. So different individual, how the programmer wrote it, how the sales executive described it. So just because of the different individual characteristics, they are able to interpret it differently and they have been able to come out of the, and have been able to perceive it very differently. So this is what perception is all about. And I hope you found this lecture meaningful and knowledgeable. So do like, share and subscribe. Thanks for watching.